Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Why Baseball Matters by Susan Jacoby, narrated by Hilary Huber. It seems to me that through baseball, I was put in touch with a more humane and tender brand of patriotism, lyrical rather than martial or righteous in spirit, and without the reek of saintly zeal, a patriotism that could not so easily be sloganized or contained in a high-sounding formula to which you had to pledge something vague but all-encompassing called your allegiance. Philip Roth, My Baseball Years. Introduction. Never make predictions, especially about the future. Casey Stengel. Early one Sunday morning in the spring of 1987, I was awakened by a phone call and heard a booming voice ask, "Is this Miss Susan Jacoby?" "Who is this?" I inquired suspiciously. "This is Ernie Banks," he replied cheerfully. "Oh, right," I said, and was about to hang up when he cut in. "I'm calling from Chicago to thank you for mentioning me in your wonderful review of Gary Carter's book today in the Tribune." Then I realized that the caller might actually be Banks, the beloved all-star shortstop for the Chicago Cubs when I was growing up in the 1950s. I had indeed written a review for the Chicago Tribune of a baseball book titled A Dream Season by Carter, the starting catcher for the 1986 world champion New York Mets. Carter had begun his book with a simple sentence, "I keep thinking about Ernie Banks." He went on to mention Banks as one of the many great players, elected to the Baseball Hall of Fame in his first year of eligibility, who never got a chance to participate in a World Series. Banks spent his entire 19-year career with the then woeful Cubs, in the days when a player had no right to switch teams without the assent of his owner. Because my review was to be published in Chicago, I naturally picked up Carter's allusion to Banks in my opening paragraph. Reverting to the voice of an odd 10-year-old, I said tentatively, "This is really Mr. Banks." "Call me Ernie," he replied. "Call me Susan," I said. We went on to have a long talk about the two great Chicago shortstops of the 1950s, Banks and Louis Aparicio, who played for my team, the White Sox. It all came back to me, the sun-swept afternoons at beautiful Wrigley Field, home of the Cubs, and ugly Comiskey Park, home of the Sox. Banks's iconic baseball plea, "Let's play two," on a fine day when one 9-inning game didn't seem to be enough. Aparicio's dazzling footwork in the field, the recollected happiness of a game that has been a part of me for nearly as long as I can remember. A game I learned in front of the television set in my grandfather's bar. Concluding our conversation, Banks gave me the greatest compliment any baseball legend could give a mere fan. I told myself when I read that article, "The girl is in the game." I became a passionate fan because my grandfather owned a bar and bowling alley in Harvey, Illinois, a blue-collar community just south of Chicago. Until I was 10 years old, I spent the better part of my summer Saturday afternoons knocking back Shirley Temples while Gramps customers explained the inside game to the little girl sitting on a bar stool with her legs propped up by liquor cartons. My grandfather had invested shrewdly in the first color television set in the neighborhood. He had invested just as shrewdly in 1932, 2 days after Franklin D. Roosevelt won the Democratic nomination for the presidency, in a decrepit bar that had been shuttered throughout Prohibition. "Everyone knew that Roosevelt was going to win," he told me, "and that it was just a matter of time until beer would be legal, and then everything else. I was terrified that someone would snap this place up in the 48 hours it took me to round up $100, no easy task, I can tell you, for an option to buy as soon as I could get a lawyer to draw up the papers." Prohibition, which had been in effect since January 17, 1920, was repealed on December 5, 1933. As Southsiders, nearly all of my grandfather's customers were Sox fans, although we occasionally watched the Cubs, Especially if the still Brooklyn Dodgers were in town and we would get a chance to see Jackie Robinson. By the time I was in first or second grade, I was very much aware of the significance of Robinson. In the summer of 1953, Gramps took me to Wrigley Field because the Dodgers were in town. Jackie didn't do anything special that day, but every time he stepped up to the plate, he was greeted by a combined chorus of cheers and boos, with taunts of the N-word audible among the latter. Banks, who would become the first black player for the Cubs, was not on the field. He was called up from the minor leagues in September, and his first full major league season was 1954. I am told by Cubs fans of my generation that racial epithets vanished rapidly from Wrigley after Banks, who became one of the most popular players in the club's history, established himself as that rare baseball figure, a power-hitting shortstop. During the game I attended with my grandfather, I was very upset. The N-word, which I had heard on the school playground, was explicitly forbidden in both my parents' and my grandparents' homes. Gramps turned around and told one man in the row behind us to stop using such language in front of children, but the day was spoiled. I couldn't stop talking about it at the bar the following Saturday, and one of the men said to Gramps, "Jim, you shouldn't have exposed her to that." He replied, "She should grow up knowing what other people have endured." Then he added, "I remember this precisely. I'm ashamed of myself that I didn't say something a lot stronger." Ah, those long talk-filled Saturday afternoons, ending only when, if the game didn't go into extra innings, wives came to fetch their husbands home for dinner around 5 o'clock. There was nothing I wanted to do more than listen, on and on, to the arguments about baseball and everything else conducted in Chicago's distinct second and third generation Irish-American accents. I now realize that this regular time out of time, spent listening to and talking with adults while watching the game we all loved for as long as the game lasted, was as different from today's technology-obsessed childhood as my childhood was from the one described by Laura Ingalls Wilder in her Little House on the Prairie series, set in the 1870s and 1880s. Looking back, I see that when I walked into my grandfather's bar, I was not only getting ready to watch the White Sox play the hated Yankees, but was entering the previous 7 decades of American history, as taught by the men who, like Gramps, had been born in the late 1880s and 1890s. I told a young friend, a fantasy baseball enthusiast who rarely attends games or watches them on television, that I was planning to write a short book about the challenges facing baseball as a game and a business in an era of fragmented attention spans and unprecedented competition for fans' attention among all sports. His response was, "Oh, you're going to write another one of those books about how wonderful things would be if baseball remained exactly the same as it was 20 or 30 years ago. Sunny afternoon games, the green of the field, fathers playing catch with sons." That is not my intention, because I do not think that everything about the game was better several decades ago, or even in the halcyon days preserved in selective memories of my childhood. Actually, sunny afternoon games had become as rare by the late 1980s as players who spent their entire careers on one team. My concerns about the future of baseball, a $10 billion sport enjoying an unprecedented era of financial success and labor peace, are not based on misplaced nostalgia for a pure game that never existed. They are based on the dissonance between a game that demands and depends on concentration, time, and memory, and a 21st century culture that routinely disrupts all three with its vast menu of digital distractions. To regain the attention of young fans, baseball will have to reinvent itself again, as it did after the First World War, when the lively ball era came into its own with the arrival of Babe Ruth. As it did when the old system of a team owning players was replaced by free agency in the late 1970s. As it did when baseball finally owned up to its drug problem, which vitiated so many records of the 1990s. Can baseball get the minds of the young back in the game, even though the culture of my grandfather's bar is gone? I hope so, because next to reading and making love, no other pastime has given me more pleasure and knowledge throughout my life. But I never make predictions, especially about the future. 1. The good and bad old days. The best words, the most fun words in our language are play ball. Former Commissioner of Baseball, Peter Ueberroth. Before baseball can move ahead to confront the true challenges posed by the 21st century's culture of distraction, it is necessary to distinguish between essential memories of the real game and an unwarranted idealization and mythicization of a pastime often presented as part of an age of innocence that never existed. When I hear older fans talk about this so-called innocence, I am always reminded of what one of my father's contemporaries, a World War II combat veteran, said about the tendency of Americans to call the battle against the Nazis the Good War, in contrast to the controversial Bad War in Vietnam. "There are just wars," my dad's friend said, "but no war should ever be called good." I suspect that my own nostalgia, to the extent that it colors my thinking about baseball, has as much to do with the grandfather I loved and with his bar as with the game itself. But there is certainly nothing warm and fuzzy about the memory of racial epithets spouted in a Major League Baseball park 6 years after Jackie Robinson became the first Black American to play in the 20th century major leagues. Indeed, this experience belonged to the decidedly unsentimental side of my education, in a school more realistic and rigorous than the one I attended on weekdays. Baseball, the business, is and always has been affected and afflicted by all the social realities of American life, from racial segregation through drug use. But if the business of baseball is just like life, the game of baseball, as it is played on the field, is anything but a reflection or representation of ordinary experience. Those of us who love the game between the lines should acknowledge that we love it precisely because it is not like life. Baseball, played as it should be, is fair and governed by rules. Never was the difference between baseball and life demonstrated more vividly, in a fashion that could be backed up by statistics as well as emotion, than during the thrilling 2016 World Series between the Chicago Cubs and the Cleveland Indians, a 7-game drama with a final act that ended during the closing weeks of the most disturbing and mendacious presidential campaign in modern American history. Was the presidential election rigged, as then-candidate Donald J. Trump claimed? Presumably it was not, since Trump won in the Electoral College while losing the popular vote, even though he had insisted that the proceedings were rigged against him. But the millions of Americans, Trump and Hillary Clinton supporters alike, who forsook the endless campaign coverage for the World Series, could be certain of one thing. The spectacle they were watching on the field wasn't rigged, right through the dramatic 10-inning comeback win by the Cubs in the 7th game. According to Nielsen Sports, more than 40 million Americans tuned in to the decisive contest, making it the most watched baseball game in 25 years. It may not be surprising that in Chicago and Cleveland, 70 and 69% of households with television sets on were tuned to the game. This figure is known as a share in the ratings industry. What is more surprising is that throughout the country, in places with no rooting interest in either team, the share was 40%. Viewership for the 7th game of the 2017 World Series, in which the Houston Astros defeated the Los Angeles Dodgers, was down 28% from the 2016 7th game. The lower ratings were due not to any lack of excitement in the overall 7-game series, but to a more pedestrian final game, in which the Astros took command with 5 runs in the first 2 innings. In both 2016 and 2017, years marked by political upheavals and natural disasters, a lifelong baseball fan could be reasonably certain of one thing. The men on the field were playing by the rules, and most of the rules would have been just as recognizable to my grandfather as they are to me. Yet for any modern fan who looks at baseball honestly, nostalgia cannot be the driving force in love of the game. Yes, I plead guilty to a wistful longing for more of the day games I remember from my childhood. But the truth is that during the week, like most adults, I can make time only to watch night games. I still hate the American League's designated hitter rule, adopted in 1973, which eliminates a key strategic element from the game, the manager's decision about when or whether to remove a pitcher in favor of a pinch hitter. And I am not happy about the game's current tilt toward strikeouts and home runs, both of which have been occurring at a record rate in recent years. I realize that there are many fans who can't get enough of home runs, but I am already sick of seeing too many games in which sluggers hit the ball out of the park with no one on base, but seem unable to bring a runner home from third with less than two out by hitting an undramatic fly ball or single. I state these reservations up front in the interest of truth and packaging. Fans like me, according to one writer who favors speeding up the game, have grouchy reasons for resisting any proposed changes in baseball. Grouchy reasons such as the sanctity of the record books and the game's intergenerational history. Grouchy reasons that amount to tired pieties that hold progress at bay. But is it grouchy to insist on distinguishing between changes for the better and changes for the worse? Baseball, despite its robustness as a business, faces a number of serious challenges that guarantee change in the next decade. The question is, which changes will enhance rather than detract from the special national significance and beauty of the game? Indeed, part of the reason I love baseball as much as I did when I was a child is the game's periodic ability to reinvent itself and transcend some of its self-inflicted abominations as well as external social pressures. When I was a child, back in the good old days, Major League Baseball, MLB, operated with a so-called reserve clause in the uniform contract that prevented a player from negotiating for what his services were worth on the open market and bound him to one team for his playing life, unless his owner agreed to trade him, or, as also happened, traded him against his will. Baseball, as it was then, however famous and beloved some of its stars became, resembled nothing so much as indentured servitude. This truth was not fully understood by the many American men who fantasized about the privilege of being a serf in Wrigley Field or Yankee Stadium. They seldom considered how they would feel if, when offered an ordinary job by an employer at a higher salary, they could not accept because their present owner had exclusive rights to their services. I heard almost no talk about the economics of baseball when I was learning the game as a child. My grandfather did mention Babe Ruth's famous response when, in 1930, a reporter asked him whether he thought he ought to be making $80,000 a year when President Herbert Hoover's salary was only $75,000. "I had a better year than Hoover," the Babe supposedly said. The reserve clause was hardest on great players like Ernie Banks, whom no owner in his right mind would have traded in the prime of his career. Mediocre players, by contrast, sometimes had the good fortune to be traded and land on a winning team. The reserve clause was finally abolished in 1975, after years of bitter dispute, culminating in a lockout of players by owners who refused to accept an arbitrator's ruling, upheld by the courts, against them. Although the owners had predicted that the end of the reserve clause would mean the end of baseball as a business, that did not, surprise, surprise, happen. Eventually, the owners and the players' union reached an agreement, modified many times over the years, in which any player can become a free agent and negotiate with any team after 6 years in the major leagues. Yet even today there are curmudgeons who fulminate about the vast riches a great or even an average player can acquire under the current system. This sentiment is probably the reason why Marvin Miller, head of the Players' Union between 1966 and 1982, the bitter height of the battle over the reserve clause, has, shamefully, not been admitted to the Baseball Hall of Fame. I am not among the curmudgeons. Why shouldn't players with extraordinary skills, skills that, as baseball statistics tell us clearly, declined for nearly everyone after the early 30s, make what they are worth to their teams in the days of their youth? I don't begrudge Gary Carter or Reggie Jackson the money they made or the money I spent on tickets to see them play. Jackson, who signed a 5-year, $2.96 million contract with George Steinbrenner's New York Yankees in 1976, was among the early free agents who were able to take advantage of the reserve clause's demise. One of the most frequent comments from older fans at the time was that no one playing a kid's game was worth that much money, which didn't stop the grumblers from watching Jackson's epic home runs. Why would I, as a fan, feel nostalgic for the days when the player who provided the thrills called his employer his owner? The brilliant pitcher Tom Seaver, the face of the young Mets franchise and its transformative leader from lovable losers into 1969 world champions, was traded to the Cincinnati Reds in 1977 after M. Donald Grant, the Mets' chairman of the board, told him, "You're making too much money at a young age. It isn't good for you." As Seaver explained to the writer Roger Angel, "My owner said that to me. And for me to say, my owner, is the most ridiculous thing in the world. Does anybody own anybody else in this country?" There is a strong case to be made that if baseball had not reinvented its business model, with the players pushing the owners every step of the way, the pre-industrial character of the game's labor relations would eventually have poisoned the well for many fans, as well as the players themselves. To cite a smaller example of baseball's capacity for reinvention, or for correcting its own mistakes, one need only turn to the 1980s, the heyday of artificial turf, surely one of the greatest atrocities produced by late 20th century technology's application to sports. Fake turf is now a bad chapter in baseball history, in part because its unyielding surface was responsible for many player injuries. When it came time to build new parks to replace the artificial turf stadiums dating from the 1970s, the green of the field was, once again, made of grass. The 1992 opening of Oriole Park at Camden Yards in Baltimore, the first of the new grassy retro parks, was part of a process of self-correction at which baseball seems, albeit often grudgingly, to excel. Of course, putting sod back on the playing field is much easier than facing and correcting a moral flaw that undermines the perception of baseball's fairness, the heart of the game's enduring appeal. The steroid era in the late 1990s and early 2000s, which cast doubt on every record set during that period, was just such a moral flaw, and it vitiates the marketing of nostalgia to fans over age 20. Both players and owners initially preferred to turn a blind eye to what was happening. In 2007, a report submitted to the Commissioner of Baseball by former Senator George Mitchell of Maine concluded that for more than 10 years, there had been widespread use of anabolic steroids and other performance-enhancing substances by players in violation of federal law and federal policy, and that those who have illegally used these substances range from players whose major league careers were brief to potential members of the Baseball Hall of Fame. Mitchell, who was knighted by Queen Elizabeth II in 1998 after helping broker a peace agreement in Northern Ireland, was a man whose judgment and impeccable negotiating credentials could not be dismissed. He had plenty of hard evidence for his report, because in 2002, MLB and the Players' Union had signed the first random drug testing agreement for players. In 2005, disgusted fans had listened as their former athletic idols did their best to evade the questions of a congressional investigating committee. For most viewers, the evasions came across as outright lies, though they were clever lies that did not meet a legal definition of perjury. Given the public's general disapproval of Congress's performance, expressed in repeated public opinion polls, it ought to be difficult for any witness at a legislative hearing to appear insolent rather than sympathetic. Nevertheless, the former slugger Mark McGuire managed it. His mantra throughout the 2005 hearings was, "I'm not here to talk about the past." What fan, after hearing that, could feel like anything but a dupe for having taken great pleasure in the 1998 contest between McGuire and Sammy Sosa in pursuit of Roger Maris's record of 61 home runs in a single season? McGuire wound up with 70 homers and Sosa with 66. Sosa, who also testified before the committee, was more measured in his language. "To be clear, I have never taken illegal performance-enhancing drugs," he said. That sounds clear enough, were it not for the fact that over-the-counter anabolic steroids are legal in Sosa's native Dominican Republic, where he spent much of the off-season. One of the saddest cases was Rafael Palmeiro, who flatly denied using steroids, but tested positive for the anabolic steroid stanozolol just 2 months later, as he was closing in on his 3,000th hit. Palmeiro, one of only five players in baseball history to have ended his career with more than 3,000 hits and 500 home runs, would surely have been elected to the Hall of Fame had he not been entangled in the steroid mess. Moreover, unlike some other high-profile players involved in the investigations, he was always considered a model teammate and a model of community service off the field. Nearly all the players who were engulfed by the steroid scandal, including Barry Bonds and Roger Clemens, would probably have been great had they never used banned performance-enhancing drugs to extend their careers, heal from injuries more swiftly, and bulk up their muscles, thereby pursuing an advantage over those who played by baseball's traditional rules. It should be noted here that because baseball had no drug testing policy in the 1990s, these players are guilty only in the court of baseball opinion, as reflected in the Mitchell report. In real criminal proceedings, Clemens was acquitted of federal perjury charges in 2012, and Bonds' conviction for obstruction of justice was overturned by a federal appeals court. Human growth hormone, which Clemens was accused of using, is much more difficult than anabolic steroids to detect in urine. The history of the steroid era remains highly contested today, since many star players from the 1990s have been, so far, barred from enshrinement in Cooperstown. That may change, because younger members of the Baseball Writers Association, the group that selects Hall of Fame members, tend to judge players like Clemens and Bonds less harshly than their older colleagues for having set records while juiced up on banned performance-enhancing drugs. On this issue, I hope that the older heads prevail. I consider it entirely possible, though, that future generations of sports writers, raised in a culture far more permissive regarding many types of drugs than was the case as recently as the 1980s, will decide that the statute of limitations has expired and let the ancient steroid users into the Hall of Fame. One of the stupidest arguments for granting the drug abusers a pass is the frequently proffered rationale that players like Babe Ruth were known to drink heavily, and there is no reason why they should be in the Hall of Fame while Bonds and McGuire are kept out. This argument ignores the fact that alcohol, unlike steroids and human growth hormone, is a performance-impairing rather than a performance-enhancing drug on and off the field. The real importance of the Mitchell report, with its account of a pervasive drug culture within baseball, lies in its application to the spirit as well as the letter of rules designed to establish an equal playing field. No one has articulated the significance of rules more precisely, albeit in a different context, than A. Bartlett Giamatti, best known as a classics scholar and the president of Yale before he became president of the National League in 1986 and commissioner of Major League Baseball in 1989. Giamatti was interpreting baseball's rules against players gambling on the game, but the same logic would later apply to stars who had set records while using banned drugs. In Giamatti's final act as commissioner, his time in office lasted only 5 months because he died of a heart attack at age 51. He banned Pete Rose from the game for life because he bet on baseball as a player and a manager. The commissioner's statement combined idealism with tough-mindedness, and it upheld a standard of fairness somewhat higher than the measures of fairness, insofar as they exist, are applied to life outside the lines. I believe baseball is a beautiful and exciting game, loved by millions, I among them, and I believe baseball is an important, enduring American institution. It will come as no surprise that, like any institution composed of human beings, this institution will not always fulfill its highest aspirations. I know of no earthly institution that does, but this one, because it is so much a part of our history as a people, and because it has such a purchase on our national soul, has an obligation to the people for whom it is played, to its fans and well-wishers, to strive for excellence in all things and promote the highest ideals. I will be told that I am an idealist. I hope so. I will continue to locate ideals I hold for myself and my country in the national game as well as in other of our national institutions. And while there will be debate and dissent about this or that or another occurrence on or off the field, and while the game's nobler parts will always be enmeshed in the human frailties of those who, whatever their role, have the stewardship of this game, let there be no doubt or dissent about or goals for baseball or our dedication to it, nor about our vigilance and vigor and patience.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.